I want to speak tonight on three types of fool. F-O-O-L. Three types of fool. Now, I don't want anyone jumping the gun and getting upset with me, but if you listen, you'll understand what I mean by this. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We'll just lift a few verses out, but you can mark this chapter, for we will refer to it. It's good to see our brother John Broderick from UCB Ireland with us. Bless him. He's going to give his testimony on Thursday night, aren't you, John?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, we're looking forward to that. God bless you. Flown in straight by helicopter from Dublin. So we're looking forward to it, John. Bless you. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, please, and verse 18. The apostle writes, verse 18, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolishness the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe." Let's pray. Father, we pray that you would take a weak vessel in my inability, and Lord, that you would hide me, and Father, that your Son, the Lord Jesus, thine only begotten, the one and only Son of God, we pray that he would be exalted, that he would be magnified, that he would be lifted up, and that someone in this place tonight has come in, and they would hear of saving grace. They would hear that everything is found in him, the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for so many coming in on this Monday evening. And we ask you, Lord, to bless your people, those who are hurting. Would you help them? Those who are maybe sick in body, would you heal them? Sitting in your presence, Lord, divinely touch them. We pray, Lord, if there's one unsaved, that you would draw them, quicken them, give them the saving grace, enable them to see the Lamb of God, call for mercy, be born again of the Spirit, and washed in the blood. We worship you. We thank you now, Lord, we sense you're settling the meeting. We thank you, Lord, that your Spirit is coming with peace. And we thank you, Lord, you're just already settling our hearts. We love you. We worship you. We wait upon you for your anointing. For without you, we can do nothing. We bless you. We praise you. We magnify you. Lord, we're not in a hurry, because, Lord, you're precious to us above all things. Will you take your word? Will you take your own word? Now take it and wing it to hearts. For Jesus' name's sake. Amen. Three types of fool. Three types of fool. We're going to speak about the perishing fools. Perishing fools. Secondly, we'll speak about preaching fools. Preaching fools. And thirdly, we will speak about purchased fools. Purchased fools. Perishing fools, preaching fools, and purchased fools. The perishing think the preaching of the cross is foolishness. I want to say it again. I want to take my time at it, that you get it. The perishing think the preaching of the cross is foolishness. The perishing think the fools who are to preach and those who preach the word of God, those who are unsaved, who are unbelievers, they think that we are fools who stand and proclaim salvation in Christ alone. They think every Christian is a fool to believe in God and that he could save through the blood of a lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ. So they think we are fools, and yet the Bible says that the perishing are the foolish ones, that those who are perishing are foolish. Notice this in our reading, 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 18. We have perishing fools, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. And what he's saying here is that they think that we're fools, preaching fools. But really, when we look at what God's word says, those who think that of us, they are the ones who are foolish. Why? Because there's a little word there that says they are perishing. Perishing, and they don't even realize it. Perishing, and they're unaware of it. Someone in here, and you think the man at the front is a fool. The man at the front says, I agree. But what kind of fool am I? We'll look at it later. But the Bible says that the perishing are the foolish ones. So perishing fools, and then again the verse says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. So here we have preaching fools. That those who preach, those who witness, those who testify, those who live for Christ, those of us brothers and sisters who love the Lord Jesus with all that we are and have, the word thinks of you and I as preaching fools. Thirdly, it talks about purchased fools. Purchased fools. Verse 18, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved. There's the purchased. Unto us which are saved. It is the power of God. Those who have been purchased by Christ, the fools who have been purchased with precious blood, amen. It's the power of God in our lives. Realizing there's nothing in ourselves, there's nothing from ourselves that we would be able to do to save ourselves. Notice this, purchased fools. Unto us which are saved. The preaching of the cross is foolishness to the world. The preaching of the cross is foolishness. Listen, in many churches today, it may upset. It may not be the right message. Don't go too hard. Preach Christ, brother. Preach Christ, sister. Live Christ, brother. Live Christ, sister. People call you a fool. And you can say, I'm a fool. Yes, I'm a fool. I'm a fool for Christ. Oh, we're preaching fools. Wherever our lives are, yes, the saved. We're purchased fools. Fools of Christ. Fools for Christ. And we are full of Christ. We have been purchased by Christ. We are purchased fools. What kind of fool are you tonight? A perishing fool? Are you a preaching fool who is a purchased fool? Notice this, fools who were perishing. Notice fools who once were perishing. You're looking at one. I was a perishing fool. I was perishing in the world. I was perishing in my sin. I was perishing in the clubs. I was perishing in the pubs. I was a perishing fool. And now tonight, I'm a preaching fool. A fool for Christ. I was a perishing fool, steeped in alcohol. A perishing fool, heavy in addiction of drugs. I was a perishing fool with a foul mouth and a mind like a sewer pipe. But now, I'm a preaching fool because I'm a purchased fool by the blood of Christ. What kind of fool are you? Are you still perishing? I'm no longer perishing. I'm saved by sovereign grace. Saved by the blood of the Lamb, covered and cleansed in the crimson flow. Notice this. Fools who were once perishing are now purchased fools and preaching fools. Purchased from perishing through the preaching of the word. Purchased from perishing through the preaching of the cross, which being a fool I once thought it was foolishness to speak of a man dying on a tree, to save thou whosoever will. It was foolishness to me. I once thought it foolishness, but now I know the man who died on the tree and the preaching of the cross is not foolishness, but it is the power of God. Amen. We need to see our churches turning around again. Amen. And how will we turn them around? Preach the power of God. Amen. How do we preach the power of God? Preach the cross. Amen. Preach the blood. Amen. Preach from the book. Amen. The blood and the book. Purchasing the perishing through the preaching in power. Purchasing the perishing through the preaching in power. First of all, let's look at these fools. We want to look at the perishing fool. The perishing fool. The word perishing is the word apolome or apolome. And it means to destroy, to put to ruin, to put out of the way. Listen, to be lost. And metaphorically speaking, it gives the idea of those who are lost and put away in eternal punishment, perishing eternally, forever. A solemn note has hit the place. A solemn voice has spoken. Perishing forever. Psalm 14 and verse 1 and also Psalm 53 and verse 1 quote the same words. Listen, the fool hath said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none that doeth good. Notice, the fool hath said in his heart. Now listen, there are many people who try to act, you know, all brave and full of brashness. And they say, I don't believe in God. But deep in their hearts, you know, maybe you've been brought up in a godly home. Maybe you've been brought up under praying parents and grandparents. And you know that way deep inside there, there's something gnawing at you that that's not true. But then there are those who say from their heart with disdain toward Christ and his gospel. The fool hath said in his heart, there is no God. Listen to what the Bible says about those who really in their heart have said this. It says they are corrupt. They're corrupt. Listen, the word here for corrupt is the word shakath. And it means they're being destroyed. They're going to ruin and into spoil. They're being corrupted. And listen, here's a word we use every day in Ulster. It means, and it's used twice in the English, the same word, sakaf, in the English word is used twice in the scriptures. It means they're wasters. Now that's strong language. I didn't say that. The Bible says, the fool has said, way in his heart, there is no God. And God says, you're a waster. Oh, wow, don't say that. That's offensive. I didn't say it. God said it. God said it. For example, Proverbs 18 and verse 9. And this is the Bible again, it's not me. Listen, Proverbs 18 and verse 9. He also that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is a great waster. It's the same word, shakath, for corrupt. I'll read it again, Proverbs 18 and 9. He also that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is a great waster. In other words, he says, the one who is slothful, the one who doesn't want to move, the one who's sitting lying back, brother, sister, I trust it's none of us tonight. I pray it's not one of us tonight. He says, those of us who are like that, you're like the brother who is the waster. And it gives the idea, you're like one who's being destroyed. You're just like him. You're like one who's going to ruin and into spoil in your faith. You're becoming corrupted. And he's saying, listen, the Holy Spirit would say to you, he would say tonight, don't let yourself go to waste. Don't let yourself go to waste. Don't be slothful in the work of the Lord, Christian, but give ourselves a shake. And that's work with all our hearts on to his glory. Notice this. In Luke chapter 12, we have the parable of the man who has a great harvest of crop. You can turn with me if you want to, or you can listen. Luke chapter 12 and verse 16. And he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do, because I have no room where to bestow my fruits? And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. Now listen, but God said unto him, but God said, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Toward God. The word here for fool, fool changes a little, and I'm going to show you a few differences in the word, the words under the English word fool. And this is important. The word fool here is the word aphron, and it means senseless, without reason, without reflection, being unwise. Now let me say it again. It means senseless, without reason, without reflection, being unwise. The Lord Jesus telling this parable of the man and says, I will say to my soul, talking to himself. I talk to myself, do you? It's time to talk ourselves into the things of God, not out of it, into the service of the King. I'll say to my soul, listen, he talks to himself. Soul. Ken. You have a way to go here. God says you have a way to go. He speaks to your soul. And you put your name there. I will say to my soul, in the heart, the fool hath said in his heart. What do you say? I will say to my soul, soul, give thanks unto God, for he has blessed me abundantly. I will say to my soul, I will love thee, O Lord, with all my strength. I will say to my soul, no. Soul, take thine ease. Look, you have much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease. Eat, drink, and be merry. Have your own way. Live your own lifestyle. Do your own thing. And from the heart, he's realizing, this is what I'm being led by my own desires. But God said, thou fool, you're a fool. You're perishing, and you're a fool. You're a perishing fool, he says. He says, you're senseless, man. He says, you're without reason. I can't talk to you. He says, you're without reflection on what you're thinking. You're without reflection on what you're deciding. You're without reflection and you don't understand. You're unwise in your decision. And Jesus said, God said, thou fool. Listen, this night. I'm only in my teens, or I'm only in my 20s, or I'm only in my 30s. Listen, death is no respecter of persons. Just last year, a young man went to work and put his boots on in the morning. He was dead by 9 o'clock in the morning, and I buried him. Somebody else took his boots off. This night thy soul shall be required of thee. And all that which you hold on to, and all your lifestyle that you want, and all your own desires that you crave, and all the things that you put in my place. Oh, the greatest idol I have known. Whatever that idol be, help me to tear it from thy throne and worship only thee. He says, all the things you desire, who are you going to leave it to? Be dead. This night thy soul shall be required of thee. What if it was your soul tonight? These are perishing. They're lost. They're being put to ruin. They're the perishing fool. I, as I said, was a perishing fool. Listen, I'm not here to talk to people as if I'm absolutely wonderful and I deserve everything. I deserve hell. That's what I deserve. But mercy found me. And grace came. Love washed over me at the place called Calvary. Don't be fooled by the nice colored shirt and tie. That's all it is. The only good thing in me is the Holy Spirit of God. I was a perishing fool, up to no good, living my way, and God could have said at any moment. In fact, I thought it had come in drunken and drug-induced stupors numbers of times. I was rolled under a hedge after collapsing at a party. They thought I was dead, and it carried me away. And they thought, well, get rid of him in case the police come. And I woke up in about 3 or 4 in the morning. I didn't know where I was, under a bush. They thought, well, somebody will find his body. And even in that moment, he still knew where I was. He still loved me. And he bought me. Oh, friend, that's what he brings tonight. That's what we offer tonight. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, Father, he's altogether lovely. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Oh, I was a perishing fool. Is there a perishing fool tonight? He'll say, I need to be purchased. I need to be saved. Let's look secondly and quickly at the preaching fool. 1 Corinthians 1 verse 18 says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. See, those who are perishing think that we're fools. The cross, the preaching of the cross, the preaching of the blood, the preaching of Christ is foolishness. Now, the word foolishness here changes again. It's the word moria. Moria. And it means absurd. Very, very silly. And so the world looks at someone like me standing here, or you in work, Christian, or wherever you are, witnessing to them, and they think you're just absurd to believe in an invisible God. And they think you're absurd to believe that a man died on a cross for your salvation. In fact, if they're kind to you, they'll think you're very, very silly. But here's the thing. Paul says, those who are perishing, the perishing fools, look at us and they say that when we're preaching the cross, it's foolishness. You're a fool. You're absurd and you're silly. But the word moria comes from the root word moros. And it's even stronger. It means dull. He's a wee bit dull. It means stupid. Imagine that. Must be stupid. Listen to this one. I found this in the Greek New Testament from a writer. You're a blockhead. I don't know where they got that one from. In other words, you're thick. Or if you're from Dublin, the way John is, you're tick. Not right, John? I'm tick. Bless you, brother. And so really what they're saying is, with disdain at them, at the nicest point, is you're very, very silly. It's absurd. But really they're saying, you're dull. You're stupid. You're a blockhead. You're thick. See this word moros. Do you know the Lord Jesus used this? I can't go through it. He used it quite a number of times. It's where the root word from where we get our English word moron from. See your man up on that platform? He's a moron. I am for the Lord. I am for him. You see Jill singing earlier on, getting up here with a mic and singing? He's a moron. Sorry. That's the word. That's the word. It's flowered up in English. Is it any wonder we get opposition from the world? The spirit of the world? The spirit of Antichrist that's in the world? Is it any wonder that we get opposition as Christians? Jesus says in the world you'll have tribulation. But what does he say? He tells us that we're not to be afraid. Why? He says, for I have overcome the world. I'll keep you awake, wouldn't I? I learned a few tricks. I don't mean tricks. I mean, you know, I learned a few techniques. And when I was first preaching, I used to preach in nursing homes. Here, help them. And when many of them were falling asleep, it was good in one way, because when you were just learning to preach, they didn't know what remember because they were sleeping what you were talking about. But sometimes when you felt you were hitting the bell, they fell asleep on you, and you used to go, "And the Lord said," and everybody. So you learn to be tricked. Keeps us awake. How did we get there? I was all serious now. Okay, so the Lord, in Matthew chapter 25, tells us the parable of the five wise and the five foolish virgins. And the five wise have oil in their vessels and in their lamps. Keep them burning. Give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning. And we're told that the five foolish run out of oil. And they go to buy oil. And when they're gone, there's a cry about midnight. Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Hallelujah. And those who were ready were told that the coming of the bridegroom went in with him. And the foolish come back. Open unto us, Lord. And he says, I don't know you. The word here for foolish is the word moros. You know what Jesus says? There were five wise virgins, but five of them were morons. Doesn't that sound terrible? Because that's a strong word in our language. But that's the word that is used. They were moronic. You know why? Because they should have known better that they were waiting on the bridegroom. They knew that he was coming. They knew that he was coming and they would be married to him if they were ready. And listen, friend, there are those who know, who are well in their heart, and they've walked away from Christ. And they have backslidden, and the Lord is returning soon. And there will be a cry about midnight hour. Behold! The bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. And the Lord will say, you know what? There's some of yous are ready, he says, but some of yous are moronic. Don't be offended at me. This is the way. This is the strength of the word. Look, if I come up here and told you, here's five ways to have a nice day. Here's 10 ways to have a blessed life. And if I had nicer teeth, it's mine. He wouldn't let me back on the platform. You see, what we're lacking is we're lacking the preaching of the Word of God. And that's why the church is in the state it's in. It's apostate all over the place. Imagine me going to some of the churches and saying, Jesus says half of you are morons. That's what he's saying. Lord, I want to seek your face to make sure. I want to be in that number. Notice this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1 again. Let's read down. Let me get it to you. Let's read down from verse 22. For the Jews required a sign and the Greeks seek after wisdom. See, the Jews required a sign. They were looking for Messiah. They missed him. The Jews were looking for a champion on a horse. He's coming again, but they've missed him as their savior. They were looking for something visible. They were looking for a champion to release them from the Roman Empire. And this lowly figure of a man comes, believed to be a carpenter. And he says, I'm going to die. And that's your salvation? And they're looking, they're saying, you must be joking. Yet it was to him give all the prophets witness. The Jews required a sign. The Greeks seek after wisdom. They're usually all the great orators and going down the street and nice poetic voices. They were waiting for somebody to come out and to speak great words of oratory that would just completely wipe everyone out. And you know, if they had to listen, they came back from Jesus and many said, never man speak like this man. They missed him. Am I speaking to someone here? You've been looking for a sign and you just haven't got it. Here it is. Don't miss him. Don't miss him. Am I speaking to someone you're saying, well, if I could hear something extraordinary and great swelling words, listen, not mine, but God's word to you tonight, don't miss him. Don't miss him. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. I love this, verse 23. But we preach Christ crucified. Notice, but we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, to the Greeks foolishness. You're not very intelligent, believing in a man to redeem you from your sin and to save you who dies on a cross. The Jews are going, hold on a wee minute, where's the champion? Oh, there's no greater champion than the one that hung and bled and died. Now look what it says here. But unto them which are called both Jew and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. You want to see the power of God? Look at the cross. That's the power of God. Listen, and I know it's been said by a well-known, renowned church leader, I'm not going into it, that the death of Christ, it was he failed on the cross. What? He failed? He triumphed over everyone on the cross. He was triumphant when he died on the cross. He gave his life freely. He says, no man take my life from me. I have the power to lay down my life. And I have the power to take it up again. He was raised again the third day. Power of God is in Christ on the cross. Notice this. He says then, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. See the word there, the foolishness of God is the word moros. Now hold on a wee minute. Do you tell me he's saying the moronic side of God? No, that's what I want. That's not what it means, you see. That which they think is moronic, that's what it means. And God. That what they think is moronic to what he does. No, you see, they look at the cross, they look at his son, they look at his blood, they see his sacrifice and they think it's moronic. Not that God's moronic. And the weakness of God. How is God weak and he's almighty? He's ever powerful and strong. I'll tell you how he became weak. In the weakness of our flesh. And he allowed them to nail him to the cross. Do you know the only place Satan tried to get a dig back at God was on the cross? He bruised his heel, but Christ crushed his head. God allowed it. It pleased the Father to bruise him, said Isaiah. Pleased the Father. I'm going to have to hurry up. Listen, 1 Corinthians verse 21, the foolishness of preaching is mentioned. For after that the wisdom of God in the word of God, the worldwide wisdom, knew not God, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching. Notice, it didn't say it pleased God by storytelling. It didn't say it pleased God by entertaining. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say it pleased God by trying to become like the world and bringing the world into the church. It didn't say that. It says it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save. How do we save? Oh, you know, we'll just bring them in and we'll tell them a nice story and we'll get them to walk up the front and we'll just lay hands on everyone. Listen, I'm not averse to laying hands on people. I'm not averse, not, and I mean in the godly way, by the way, not in a violent way. But listen, that's not how people are saved. They're saved by the preaching of the gospel. Notice the foolishness of preaching is mentioned here. And the word here for foolishness of preaching, notice it's not foolish preaching. It's the foolishness of preaching. It is not foolish preaching. There's a big difference. A crossless preaching, a Christless preaching, a bloodless preaching, a wordless preaching, repentantless preaching is foolish preaching.
But the foolishness of preaching is completely different. The foolishness of preaching is the cross of Christ, the cross work of Christ, the finished work of Christ on the cross. And you see, it's foolishness in the eyes of the world. And the foolishness of preaching is the message of redemption through the precious blood of the sinless, spotless, impeccable Son of God. Foolish preaching, or the foolishness of preaching. The foolishness of preaching to those who are perishing is the gospel of full and free salvation. Saved by grace through faith. It's a workless, effortless gospel. A gospel, the gospel of God in the person of his only begotten. Hosea 9 and 7 says this, "In the days of visitation are come, the days of recompense are come, Israel shall know it." Let's put Ulster, Ireland, let's put Great Britain in there. "The days of visitation shall come, the days of recompense shall come, Ulster shall know it, Ireland shall know it, Britain shall know it, your neighborhood shall know it." Now listen, this is what they say. Think of our land today. The prophet is a fool. The spiritual man is mad. Notice, the prophet is a fool. The spiritual man is mad for the multitude of thine iniquity and great hatred. See the word fool? It changes again. It's the word evil. And it means one who is foolish or quarrelsome. Now you think of what's happening and going on in our land today. Every time you turn on somewhere, radio or whatever, everything is anti-God, anti-word, anti-Christ, anti-Bible, anti-gospel. It's all pushing the agendas of everything and anything else that will be taken hold of, but rather than the gospel of saving grace. And know what happens when you and I speak out, when you and I stand up, you know what happens? We become the prophets. He is quarrelsome. She's quarrelsome for standing up for God. Is that not our land? Hosea, all those years ago, 700 BC or so, to the house, the northern house of Israel, and the kingdom of Israel. And he says, the Lord says, "Go tell them." And they said, "You know what? This man is a fool. The spiritual man is mad." You know what the word spiritual is, by the way? The man of the Ruach. You know what the Ruach is? The wind and Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit of God. See, the man and the woman who know the Lord and are close to Christ and filled with the Spirit. See, when we stand up and speak out, you know what happens? They say, "Hell, you're mad." Because the Holy Ghost lets you see the sin in the land. The Holy Ghost lets you see the heart of the man and woman. The Holy Ghost lets you see what's going on in the nation. The Holy Ghost lets you see what's happening in the church. The Holy Ghost allows you to see all of these things, to read the Word of God and be able to understand. And they say, "They're mad." I say, "Yeah, I'm a fool, yeah. And I'll tell you about it, I am mad. I'm mad about Jesus. I'm mad about him. You know why I'm mad about him? Because he was mad about me." We're coming to a close, our last point. Thank you for your attention. Paul says, in 1 Corinthians 4 and 10, that we are fools for Christ's sake. The word again is moros, morons. Brother, can I ask you something when you go to work tomorrow, sister, wherever you are, while it's shopping, work, wherever you do, while you're with the kids, meeting others, can I ask you, are you willing to be a moron? A moron for Christ. In other words, what you're saying is, "I don't care what you think of me. I don't care because I've been purchased. Don't care if you think of me as a moron. I'm unashamed of him." Brothers and sisters, I'm unashamed of Jesus. Are you unashamed of Christ? I'm unashamed of him and his gospel. Notice the purchased fool, lastly and quickly, 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 18. "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." Us which are saved are the purchased fools. Those who are from the perishing fool, now we're taken, we're purchased. And we're the preaching fools, so we're fools for Christ. Fools who were perishing, and we're now fools for Christ. Do you know how many of us
maybe went and were in the world before we got saved, and we give our lives, we give our time, we give our finances, we give our work, we give our energy. We'd have stayed up all night in a club and partying for days, and yet we're asked to give an hour and a half on a Sunday morning under the preaching of the word and the worship of the Lord, and it's shock and horror. Oh, big knife there. Yet that which we gave to the devil, surely with the same passion we should give to Christ. Give it to him. Brother, give it to him tonight. We are purchased fools. Listen to what it says in chapter 1, verse 21. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe, the purchased ones. Acts chapter 8 and verse 20. Simon the sorcerer, he's wanting the Holy Ghost. He's wanting the Lord to fill him. And Peter turns to him and says, but Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Do you see what God has for us and done for us? Friend, if you're not saved, do you see what God has for you? The perishing food. You can't purchase it. You can't hear the pennies dropping into the bottom of the offering plate and go to heaven. You can't bless a grave and think that a loved one's getting out of some sort of made-up purgatory. When you're there, you're there. Heaven or hell. No way out. Perishing fools. Listen to what Paul says. This is our last scripture. Acts chapter 20, verse 28, just the end of the verse. He says, feed the church of God, which he hath purchased. Love it. With his own blood. The man who hung on the cross, who we believe and others call us fools for believing in. Do you know who he was? He was God. The Son of God. Very God of very God. Man of very man. The word here, feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood, is a word, peripoieo, and it means to preserve the oneself. To get oneself. Listen, when Jesus died on the cross, he thought of you. And he thought of me. The Father gave us to him in eternity. And when he was dying on the cross, he says, I'm going to get him. I don't know why. Don't ask me why. I know how he done it. By dying for me. I don't know why he did it. But he says, I'm going to get that rascal. I'm going to get that old sinner there. I'm going to get that perishing fool, Ken Davidson. And I'm going to get him with my blood. And it means he covers me to bring him to himself. You're mine, said David. God says, my son gave his blood, shed it at Calvary, to bring you unto himself. Will you accept it? He says, you're mine. When you come, brothers and sisters, we have a wonderful Savior, a wonderful God. Carly, will you come up with it? We have a wonderful Savior. Maybe you're not saved tonight. You're perishing. Do you hear me? And don't hear me and hear the voice of God. He's saying, you're perishing. You're perishing. You don't even realize it. You're perishing. Just by a word of prayer.